asking everyone else to make sacrifices. At the Academy Awards in 2007, Leonardo DiCaprio, Al Gore walked out. They flashed on the screen green tips, use public transit. When was the last time they were on a city bus, either Al Gore or Leonardo DiCaprio? It's just a basic thing. They are not going to get people to follow them if they don't follow the lifestyle
themselves.
How did
he treat you after that?
Well, he said that you're either someone who's an ideologue or a coward to even ask that question. That was against the spirit of this whole
thing. Fortunately, you were both. You had
that's right. Well, then I interviewed Robert F. Kennedy, and they got even worse. They wanted to jail people. So they were very hostile. They actually circulated skeptics' faces out and said, don't talk to these people. They shut us down many times.
Well, actually, they do have very powerful backers. Obviously, the head of the UN, John Kerry, they have the president tomorrow. So obviously, all of these gentlemen have made this the front and primary issue today. Is that registering?
Well, I definitely think that it's registering, and it's registering with young people, which is probably the most frustrating thing, because they're just looking to these A-list celebrities who are leaving carbon footprints. But what I want to call out here is this so-called hippie hypocrisy, where what we're seeing is young people who are definitely out there, who are using cell phones, who are drinking Starbucks, who litter, and they have zero personal responsibility when it comes to taking action for something that they believe in. And they throw out their actual, you know, so-called standards for what is good community living at the first chance of convenience that they have. How hard would it have been to find a receptacle to throw away your trash?
Assemblymen, are they risking looking like hypocrites here?
Look, I think to make a march where 300,000 or 400,000 people got together to make a broad point about how we should change our economy be either about a couple of celebrities or about a few littering. It really is to miss the point of this. I've spoken with the people whose job it is every day to clean this up, the city of New York, and they said this was not an unusual amount of pressure.
All right, fair enough. And I understand that that could look like you're just scapegoating it, but not you. But this, do you think, with everything else going on in the world, you know, ISIS, you know, chopping off Americans' heads, and our own budget nightmare and debt and piling up unfunded liabilities, is this now the time to make this the number one concern with all those other concerns?
We need to be a country that can walk and chew gum at the same time. This is a crisis.
But no, all the people I mentioned that made this the number one concern.
I'm not here to speak for people whether it's the number one or the number two concern. Obviously, I'm not going to suggest to you that we should not be doing something about global terrorism. But the simple fact is that there is a very broad consensus that that the globe is warming, and it's warming at a rapid rate. And
why didn't you stick with warming?
Science actually doesn't show that.
I know you have a thing about climate change being a clever alternate phrase. I actually think warming. It is warming. It's warming consistently.
Well,
at this point.
You quibble with that, right?
Well, satellite data shows very clear there's been no global warming for almost 18 years. Every kid that marched yesterday under 18 years of old never experienced global warming in their lifetime.
Well, those kids call you a Luddite.
That's right.
And you don't see the reality.
But this is about an agenda. It's not about the science. The EU climate commissioner, a lady named Connie Hedegaard, said even if we're wrong on the science, we're doing the right thing by policy. They want to sell the same progressive left agenda, but they're just using the science to scare people to go their way because they can't sell it on its merits and not getting enough support. So they're creating a climate crisis.
Sorry to interrupt, but virtually every country in the world has signed on to the climate panel of the UN.
But not every country in the world is willing to pay for it, assuming it's what it is.
This is not about liberal politicians in the U.S. or elsewhere.
Well, no, Assemblyman, I'll take your point, but I will then say if you believe what the good Assemblyman was saying, then Ashley, every country that signed on to this has got to take an equal responsibility to pay to clean it up or to address it. And what we discover is that not every country does. India or China, to a far lesser degree than the United States, if at all. Therein lies the rub, right?
Very true. And what I'm seeing here and hearing from the Assemblyman is this fact that, you know, he's not going to speak for everybody that was at the rally when all of them were standing there in solidarity, apparently, with climate change, saying that science is on their side, when in fact scientists are coming out and saying it's not on their side. And as Mark was pointing out, you know, for the past 17 years, we haven't actually seen anything that proves that global warming is increasing. What we have seen, yes, carbon emission has gone up, but that has had no correlation to global warming or or polar caps melting or polar bears being driven out. So, you know, for him to make these claims, it's entirely false. And I would actually like to know if the assemblyman has any direct mail to his constituents that could also be leaving a carbon footprint.
It is. I doubt we're going to resolve the science here on this program today.
Well, we have time.
I'll see what I can do here. Yeah. The temperature of the globe is warming. The sea level is rising. The ice caps are melting.
How? Do you have science that shows the
level of the water around Manhattan is higher than it was a number of years ago.
But you know, Assemblyman, I don't want to get to it. He said, she said on this, but think about it. When you and I were much younger, you know, when I was a kid in college, the big thing there was the global freeze. In 1978, it was on the cover Time and Newsweek, the Leonard Nimoy documentary on the whole world was freezing.
That was
the consensus view at the time.
Not a consensus.
Well, it was. I mean, we've shown this on our website. All I'm saying is, should we be careful leaping and then paying trillions of dollars globally to address a problem that might not be
you? If you, Neil, if you were ill and 98 doctors told you you needed surgery in order to prevent terrible things from happening, and two told you they weren't sure, you'd probably have
would
the surgery.
Would I commit myself to expensive chemotherapy to address a cancer that might not be there?
Yes, people often would.
Are we at that stage?
There's no 98%, 97% is nonsense. You would not go to a doctor who is a, if you go to a doctor who does surgery versus a doctor who does it, you're more likely to recommend surgery. These are scientists. You mentioned the IPCC. They're handpicked by governments because they'll agree with the conclusion. It's pure politics masquerading as science.
But could you open to what the assembly is saying, at least, or would you disagree with it? It's an urgent crisis, as does Ashley. But Ashley, would you be open to say, all right, we can look at this and examine it? All I'm drawing a difference in is, do we need to make it the number one concern, as it has been presented at the UN, as it has been presented by the president, as it has by John Kerry, and a host of others? I'm not saying it doesn't bear watching and looking and examining and just being the better part of valor to sort of get weigh this out. But to make it number one ahead of all the other developments just shows goofed up prioritizing. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. Scientists are already looking at this. There is no consensus on it. As I said, 17 years, there's been no correlation between the two. So to make it our number one issue when we have journalists and Americans overseas who are being beheaded by a terrorist group and radical Islamists, this does not seem like the appropriate
time. Well, you say we can walk, talk, and chew gum at the same
time. Yes, and just if I can make one point. The steps that we are talking about are investing in more efficiency, on cheaper and better ways of doing things.
But aren't we already doing that?
Like getting rid of direct mail to somebody?
At a rapid rate, the number one
country. But at the rapid rate of, look what you're doing to coal. We're going to raise utility rates by 40%.
We're not going to raise the utility rates by 48%. But the number one.
What are these? Are these guys lying?
The increase in 2000, the number one increase in the world, as has been mentioned, in global gases in 2013 was China. Number two is the United States.
And then China won't be here tomorrow for the UN.
And China will be representative, although the premier.
But China is taking a pass on this part of it, right?
As has the United States.
But if we pay and China doesn't, would that bug you on some level?
That is why. That is why we are seeking a global agreement to take some reasonable steps that will spur the economy, that will increase jobs, and rather than reducing them. These are smart investments in the future.
You keep talking about walking and chewing gum. This is stepping in the gum. You have a UN treaty that even if you buy their science, the EPA regulations President Obama did, John Podesta came out and said this will help future storminess be less. They won't even impact global emissions, let alone temperature,
let alone storminess. You have nothing against fuel efficiency.
No, that's fine, but don't sell it as a solution to an urgent problem which they've ginned up. And that's the problem. Even UN treaties fully implemented would not have a detectable impact on temperature, even going by their science. It's nonsense. You should say we face the greatest threat and then you propose symbolism. If you buy the science, what you're proposing makes no sense.
I am not proposing
symbolism. Get your feet out of the gum.
I am proposing, that's a very nice metaphor, I'm proposing more aggressive efforts to incentivize
funding.
Investment.
Taxpayer dollars.
I'm talking about incentivizing investment in things that will reduce the climate impact, the greenhouse gases of these things, basically by getting us burning less fossil fuels and using more renewable energy. Many people agree that that would be beneficial. We're not doing it rapidly enough to avert what
I consider a significant
crisis.
We have a lot of that stuff here.
And it's good stuff to do, but we're not doing enough of it. Otherwise, we would not be increasing the amount of
coal. Would you want to be getting it from that section of the world where they control it all?
The reason I would prefer that we do more domestic basically produced resiliency and
solar,
energy.
Wind,
and that's
and fossil.
And that's, well, we need to, my view is we need to shift away from fossil fuels over time, and we need to do it more rapidly than we're doing now. And again,
Ashley, go ahead, finish that thought.
So Assemblyman, you think that the people who came in to protest and for the climate march this weekend, who came in on buses that were using fossil fuel, that's entirely okay. That doesn't abandon their principles at all.
I don't think we're all obligated to sit in our basement and watch this climate change nonsense
out here. Who said we